Good. Now you can hear me too. Great, good start, isn't it? It can only get better from here. So, good morning, everybody, and welcome to church. And why don't you stand? That's very nice. And I don't know if you know what today is, apart from the 27th of November. It's the first Sunday in Advent. So what does that mean? It means Christmas is coming. So we're on the countdown to Christmas. Now, you can't start opening your Advent calendars because that's not till the 1st of December. Sarah, you have to hold back. Can't open that first door, even though it's the 1st of Advent. No, not the 1st of Advent calendar, just the 1st of... What does it mean? It means that we're anticipating the birth of Christ. The birth of our Savior. And you know, with everything that goes on around Christmas, it's a pressured time for many people, especially if you've got much money. And you know, if you've got all kinds of things happening, then it gets very, oh, dear me. But actually what Christmas is all about is celebrating the fact that Jesus came to earth, born as a human being, God becoming one of us, and then ultimately leading to his death and resurrection, leading to our salvation. So it's a really important time. So the whole meaning of Advent, the purpose of Advent, is that we can get ready for that. So, you know, forget for a minute all the presents and stuff. Think about the excitement of God becoming flesh, human flesh. Amen? Amen. Good one. So having said that, then why don't you turn around and say, happy first Sunday in Advent.
Happy first Sunday in Advent.
Lovely. And now, why don't we say hello to Jesus? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for church. Thank you that we can come this first Sunday in Advent, anticipating all the celebrations about, you know, just taking joy in the fact that you came to earth as a human being. And so, Lord, as we come to worship you this morning, we forget about all the stuff that's been distracting us this morning, and we focus on you, and we want to just lift you up, and we want to be, you know, really caught up with the sense of who you are. And so we thank you that you're here by your Holy Spirit, that you're here to minister to each person who's here. And we really take joy in that. We commit this service to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now the guys are going to sing, and we're going to sing. They're going to play. And we're going to have a great time of worship. So let's do it.
Stories with faith, and I believe you're still restoring, redeeming everything here in this moment. Me will be done.
To the mother.
your presence that leads me wanting.
You now, Lord, we just bow our hearts to you and just so thankful for your greatness, your mercy, that in your holiness you still reached out to us. and came to be with us, to live amongst us, to die for us. And we just want to just be so thankful and come so close to you today, because we need you so much, so Father, in this world and in this life. We need your strength, we need your mercy, we need your Holy Spirit to guide us, to strengthen us, to encourage us, to lead us, to make us be able to follow you wholeheartedly, in Jesus' name. So God, we just worship you now. Hallelujah.
Lord, I come and I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where it's found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. And holiness is Christ in me. Song to rise to you when temptation comes my way. And when I cannot find, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. That chorus again. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. In every hour, I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. My one defense. Defense, my righteousness, how God, how I need you.
Jesus. Yes, Lord, we need you. And this is part of our service where we like to give thanks to God and praise him for the good things he's done in our lives. And time, and this is a time also when we can lift up needs in prayer to God. So, Nikki came to me and says she would just like to give thanks this morning that some friends have come to church this morning, and she's really happy and glad about that as well. That is very good. It's good to have friends. Is there anyone else here that's bold enough who wants to give a testimony or just say something good about what God's done in their life this morning? Here's your golden opportunity. Anybody want to give thanks to God this morning? No, that's okay. That's fine. Well, we thank you, God, for your goodness towards us and the good you're going to be doing in our lives. Jack got in contact with me on the WhatsApp, and he would like us to pray as a church for him because he says he's just drowning in uni work just now, and he needs to get those assignments in. Well, if you're drowning, you know, you need a savior. You need someone to help and save you. And I like one preacher. He says, you know, he who squeaks gets oiled. He who prays gets answers. Amen. So Heavenly Father, we just lift our brother Jack up to you just now. And I thank you that you said the Holy Spirit would bring to remembrance things. And everything he's studied, I just pray that you'd bring it back to his remembrance. And we just pray and ask for supernatural strength and ability in his life to get through these assignments, to bring glory to your name. And the church said, amen. We agree. That's right. We're agreeing. So thank you, Father. We thank you in advance just that Jack will do above and beyond what we can ask or imagine. I thank you just for honors in the course that he is doing. Is there anyone else here that needs prayer, who has a prayer request? Just want to give freedom. Here's your chance. He who squeaks gets oiled. God gives grace to the humble. No? Okay, well, we thank you, Father, that we can just come here in freedom and praise and worship and give you glory this Sunday morning. Amen? Amen. Amen.
Stand up and let's carry on worshiping the Lord. I would just like to encourage us all, as we sing, that we just don't go through the motions, but we actually read and understand what we're going to sing, the words that we're going to speak and sing out, because words are powerful. And this is about resurrendering to God. Yourself, your life, all your anxieties, all your worries, and he's got you, because the God we serve is alive and real. Amen. You're turning over tables.
People.
what we return to you. You are restoring what we yield anew. We are your people. You are our God. We are your temple. Make us holy like you are. We are your children. You've set us apart. God, for your glory, make us holy like you
Jesus. We thank you, Lord God, that you surrendered everything for us. And Lord God, we just open our hearts to you right now and just say we want to lay down our cares, our worries, our concerns, and just focus our hearts on you and surrender everything to you today, Lord Jesus. Because we know that in your arms there is safety. As we surrender to your will, there is peace, there is purpose, there is joy. And hallelujah, Father, even when we face difficulties and opposition, we have a confidence in you, knowing that you will deliver us, you will set us free, you will carry us through, and we are so thankful for that. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. It's good church. Sometimes we have a seat. Sometimes we feel like that. Sometimes when we feel like we're going to giving ourselves to God can actually be quite a sacrifice, but it's worthwhile. It's the same that sacrifice that Jesus gave on the cross. The Bible said that he did it for the joy that was set before him. He endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. And if we get our attitude right, we can endure so much. We can be willing to do whatever it is that God asks of us. Amen? Amen. We're just going to continue worshiping with our giving. And we're a church that believes in charitable giving. You know, we do charitable things. We're also a charity. And we want to encourage you to give today. And I want to share a quick verse with you to encourage you and how we should give. And because a lot of people say, oh, tithing's Old Testament. Yep, it is. But it's the spirit of the law that Bible that God wants us to live by, which is a spirit of generosity, a spirit of giving, not only just to a church, but to anything that we need to give to, anything where we see a need. You know, the Bible says if we know the good that we ought to do and don't do it, we're in sin. So if you see a brother or sister in need and you don't feed them, take care of them, look after them, it's the same thing as not doing it to Jesus, the Bible tells us. And so I don't want to go into a big preach about that, but I want to encourage you today with this verse because it's not pressure. It says here in 2 Corinthians 9:7, it says, each of you should give what you've decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. So we're here today to tell you we are not compelling you to give. We're not demanding that you give. We're encouraging you. And you should ask God in your heart right now, what is it you want me to give? It might be a tithe, which in Old Testament principles was 10% of your increase. So like 10% of your paycheck, if you like. Or it might be something else. It might be more than that. It might be less than that. But the principle of giving to God is all through Scripture and being willing to give to His kingdom to see His kingdom advances there. So no pressure. You give what you want. You give what God has put in your heart to give and be obedient to that. Because as you surrender your finances to God, He gains you peace. He also brings so many promises that He will look after us. He'll take care of us. He'll take care of all of our needs according to His riches and glory, which is a lot more than our riches. Amen? I'm thankful for that. I can give you some testimony after testimony, but I don't want to waste too much time of how God's looked after me. I've been giving since I was a little kid. Every week I gave a bit of my my allowance that my parents gave me. So I got a dollar a week, so I gave 25 cents, or in America we call it a quarter, you know, which is actually, well, 25% actually, but it's only a quarter, so, you know, it wasn't, you know, and I don't give 25% now, I have to confess, but if God asked me to, then I would do that, but you know, that principle of giving has been through my life, and God is so taking care of me. Sometimes I feel I'm more blessed than I should be. I don't deserve God's blessings sometimes, but I'm just so thankful. And I just want to encourage you, as you give, as you surrender your finances, either today or throughout this week or amongst sharing food with people that you meet that need it, in whatever way that God puts on your heart, God is going to look after you too. Amen? Okay, I want to just pray before this, and as you're going to hand out these things. If you're a taxpayer, you can also give under gift aid, and the government allows money to come back to the charity. You can just fill in one of the envelopes. That'd be great. You can also give online. You can see there'll be a slide popping up just shortly. You can use the QR code, or you can use the bank details, or you can use PayPal, or you can give a check, or you can do cash. Whatever works for you, works for us. And it's all about what's in your heart, not the method of payment. So don't feel guilty if you're doing it on there and not putting it in. You know, no one's watching, no one's judging. It's between you and God. So let's just pray. Father, we just thank you for the finances that you do give us. And Lord God, I thank you that we don't need to fear the days to come, the bills ahead, that Lord Father, that you have blessed us. And we're so thankful for being in a country that such as we are, that you've placed us here in this time, in this season, where we really don't need to worry as much as some other places in the world. And so God, forgive us when we are complaining about not having the best iPhone or not having the best streaming service because we can't afford it. But Lord Father, we know there's people out there that can't even find food or shoes for their feet. And so God, give us all the right heart as we give this morning, that we be cheerful givers, thoughtful givers, being aware of other people's needs around us throughout this week and not just on a Sunday morning, not just doing our bit for God. No, that's my bit for God. But Lord, that we become generous people on every occasion, every opportunity, that we would seek ways to be generous so that we can bless people with what you blessed us with. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Great. So the buckets are just going to go around. If you want to give by any of those means, you certainly can. And I'm just going to ask Pastor Mark to come up, and he's going to share us with us while we're doing that. What's going on this week?
Lovely. Thank you. So, all of you who pack shoeboxes for children for Christmas will be delighted to know that we were able to send 77 shoeboxes heading off to Ukraine. Isn't that fantastic? And I have to say the vast majority of those, I think, were from our church, rather, you know, because we collected them in Kings. So we had one or two that came from other people, but most of them came from church. So well done, everyone. And thrilling to think of what a difference those shoeboxes are going to make when they're received by the kiddies. Really great. So other things that I can tell you about, we've got prayer tonight, 6 o'clock in King's, so come along to that just for an hour. We've got youth on Friday, this Friday back on, so that's great. That'll be here, probably, but stay in touch with Davi if you want to know more. And then Jason and Danielle are getting married. Yay, yay, yay. So they've not been able to invite everyone for obvious reasons. So if you've not been invited, then please don't take it personally at all, because they would have loved to have invited you. However, if you want to squeeze in at the back for the ceremony, which is on Saturday, that's this coming Saturday, 2:30, at Maybe House, then you can, squeeze in at the back. Now, you know, they're invited guests, so the seats are for them. Unless you're elderly, infirm, then, you know, there are a few extra seats for people. But otherwise, it will be just standing at the back for the ceremony itself. And, you're welcome to come, because we love you guys. I think Danny's headed out with Vanessa. But, we're so excited for you. And really looking forward to getting you married. Yes. So big cheer for both of them. Yeah. So they won't be here next Sunday, because they'll be off on honeymoon. But we will see you, don't know if it's Sunday after that or the Sunday after that again. But yeah, we'll see you both with big smiles on your faces. Delighted to be married. And then we've got Simply Christmas on the 10th of December, so it's a week on Saturday, 7 o'clock here. There's songs, carols, stories, festive refreshments, and a great atmosphere. So please do invite people to come to that. We've got a few leaflets at the back that you can use to physically invite people if you'd like to do that. And then Christmas Day itself, then we're still looking for somebody to coordinate everything. Now, maybe I put people off last week because I was saying we're looking for a bossy person. And you don't actually have to be bossy, because I don't think we have that many. I don't think we have any bossy people in church, actually. And so, you know, if I disqualified you all by saying you have to be bossy, then please feel undisqualified, because really it's a servant role anyway, as any position of leadership is. So if you just want to help make this thing happen, then, do some of the work of coordinating. It's not difficult, like I said last week. We've got plenty of volunteers. We've got money coming in as well. The Lions Club have given us £300. They always give us a healthy donation, but I think this is more than they normally do. And so we've got other money coming in. So we're not short of cash to run the event. But we want to make it really nice. So if you would like to help with this important role, or even if there are two of you to sort of share the role of coordinating together, then that would be brilliant. But it is just something that we need to have in place before Christmas Day itself. And then also Christmas Eve, then we're going to get an incredibly large amount of food from the two Aldi stores, from the Tesco stores, from Lidl, from M&S. So that's really all the supermarkets in the town. They're all going to give us the stuff that they would have sold the next day and the day after that, because they closed 2 days, most of them. So it's all coming to us, and we've got to get rid of it all. So if you'd like to be a volunteer for that, then speak to Yasmin, because together with the Food Project team, then we'll be running that, and it'll take over the hall here on Christmas Eve in the evening. So a great project. And then after Christmas, we've got New Year. And then after New Year, we're moving into St. Mary's Church Hall. Yay! So 8th of November is the date. So if you can spare some time on that first week of the New Year, you might be off work because, it's still kind of holiday time. Then we will need to sort of set things up in St. Mary's Church Hall. Where is St. Mary's Church Hall, some of you are asking? Not far from here. It's the St. Mary's Church is opposite the Cairndale, the one with the big sort of steeply thing in sandstone set up on the hill. but the church hall is where the two roads fork. So that's St. Mary's Street heading to Lockerbie Road, this direction, and then Annan Road going the other way. So it's that building that sits right in the middle. And that's where we're going. So it's going to be fun. We'll give you leaflets and things beforehand about where to find parking and how we make that that transition over there. But the main thing is we'll have space for more people. Yes, and a great Treat Kids area as well. Lots of space for the kids and for Little Wonders. And so, you know, just room to grow. Absolutely fantastic. Right, I think I've said everything I need to say. So it's time for kids to head to the back. So are you ready, kids? Kids Church, Little Wonders. Okay, we'll just fade the music, otherwise Facebook cuts us off because it's a copyright song. So we'll play a snippet and we might get away with that. Hopefully that's great. And here's Jack. Hi, Jack. Yeah. Oh, you're not wearing shorts this week. Shucks, maybe I'll do it next week then. Wait till it snows, that's right, yes. Lovely. Now, also on the run-up to Christmas then, don't forget about Kings. What's Kings? Kings is your coffee shop and bookshop. So it's right in the town centre, belongs to the church, which means it belongs to you and to me, to all of us, because, you know, it is a social enterprise from the River of Life Church. So invite people to come and have coffee and to come and enjoy the lovely atmosphere and the incredible staff at King's. Big cheer for the King's staff. And half of you clapping for yourselves. And so that's great. And so, yeah, do make use of that, whether it's for a cup of coffee in the middle of doing other things, or whether you want to buy a Bible for somebody, or, you know, have a look at our cards and little bits and pieces, then lots to see there. Super. Now, it's my joy to introduce one of the people who helps out in Kings, and his name is Pastor Davi Santos. So would you like to stand? And let's put our hands together for the amazing Brazilian youth pastor. Well, Davi, now you're heading over to Brazil shortly, aren't you, for a little holiday. Go and see the family along with Joanna. Exciting. So we got you in to preach before you go.
Thank you, Pastor Mark. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to church, everybody in the building. Everybody at home, welcome. Well done for turning up, for turning it on your laptop or wherever you're watching it from. And everybody here, well done. Can you give a round of applause to yourselves for being here right now, turning up? And Joanne. Sorry, team. Sorry. That's stupid. I shouldn't have clapped. Well done for turning up. How amazing is it that we're here? We're here, end of November 2022. We made it. Well done. Well done. Despite all of the challenges, yeah, despite all of the reality of life, yeah, you're here. You're here now. And some of us, you know, we forget that actually. How important it is to just acknowledge, actually, we're here. You know, we're here. Thank you, God, that you're with us. And you brought us so far. You've been with us the whole time, and you're not going to leave us alone. Thank you. We here at the River of Life Church, we welcome you. If you're here for the first time, you're welcome. You don't need to believe in everything that we believe as a church, in order to belong here. We want you to feel welcome as you are. So if you're connecting for the first time, you're just curious, what's going on here? Or if you just turned up, belong. We will be upfront about what we do believe in, though. We believe in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We believe that he has set us free from ourselves, from our shame, from our selfishness, from our greed. And he set us free into generosity. He set us free into love, free to smile, free to have strength, free to endure, free to last. Thank you, Jesus, that you give us freedom. This morning, we're going to be talking about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And I'm going to read a passage of scripture from 2 Corinthians, the letter written to 2 Corinthians by the Apostle Paul. I'm reading, I'm reading chapter 4, all of chapter 4, but I'm going to start from the end of chapter 3, starting from verse 16. So, media team, bear with me. I'm always all over the place with the notes, like I give you stuff and then I don't follow it, so I apologize in advance. But can we also give it up for the media team and everybody that's behind the scenes, like making it all happen? Come on, you guys turn up earlier before everybody, you know? And we need to always remember where to put the spotlight sometimes. You know, we forget, these lights are pointed here right now, but you know, there is so much happening. There are people grinding and getting up early and serving and loving. And so this is amazing. Amazing that you guys do what you do. So let's read together. It will be on the screen if you don't have your Bible on you. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, and then going into all of chapter 4. Apostle Paul, he wrote this. Reading from the New Living Translation. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit. And wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. Following on into chapter 4 now, Paul continues writing, therefore, since God, in his mercy, has given us this new way, we never give up. We reject all shameful deeds and underhanded methods. We don't try to trick anyone or distort the word of God. We tell the truth before God. And all who are honest know this. If the good news we preach is hidden behind a veil, it is hidden only from people who are perishing. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand this message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. You see, we don't go around preaching about ourselves. We preach that Jesus Christ is Lord, and we ourselves are your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We now have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. We are pressed on every side by troubles, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are hunted down, but never abandoned by God. We get knocked down, but we are not destroyed. Through suffering, our bodies continue to share in the same death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be seen in our bodies. Yes, we live under constant danger of death because we serve Jesus, so that the life of Jesus will be evident in our dying bodies. So we live in the faith, in the face of death, but this has resulted in eternal life for you. But we continue to preach because we have the same kind of faith the psalmist had when he said, "I believed in God, so I spoke." I know that God who raised the Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and present us to himself together with you. All of this is for your benefit. And as God's grace reaches more and more people, there will be great thanksgiving, and God will receive more and more glory. That is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long. Yet they produce for us a glory that is vast, that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. After a passage of scripture like that, like, what else are you supposed to say? You know, the Bible is the Word of God, and we believe that it's alive, and it speaks to us, you know, and you can never, it's not like a video game that you finish. I've been there, done that. I've passed. Oh, the Bible. Oh, yeah. I see in the 90s or before some of you guys were born, I nailed the Bible. It's not about that. This is an opportunity, a window into connecting with God. It's beautiful. I just want to encourage all of us to just stay in touch. Stay in touch. God speaks to us through his word. You open this thing here. With belief, your eyes in wonder, and it will read you. It's beautiful. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. I want to invite you guys to just join me in prayer right now as we talk to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you're here right now. Thank you, Jesus, that you're with us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your word. Thank you that your word is sharp and it cuts right through into the deepest parts of our beings. Holy Spirit of the living God, thank you that you are present in this place. Thank you that you get in touch with us when we're not even aware. Make us aware of you. We ask right now, thank you that you have something to communicate to us. I pray that you will remove any distraction, any obstacle, anything that may be in the way, and speak to us, open our ears and open our eyes and show us something that we've not seen before. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. Guys, I'm absolutely buzzing because I'm going to Brazil. I'm excited. I'm going to see my mom. I'm a mama's boy. I love my mom. My mom's so beautiful, man. Honestly, you have no idea. I've not seen her in a while, and I am looking forward to just give her a massive hug, man. and my dad as well, and rest of the family, my sister. I just miss them. You know, time just goes quickly, and we've had a brilliant opportunity to be going home now, and we'll be back here for Christmas, which we're super excited about as well, because we want to be spending Christmas with our Scottish family as well, because God's blessed us with this. This is a thing. You know, Duke was talking about how when we seek God, you know, he does bless us. He was just mentioning here about how sometimes we're blessed beyond what we think we deserve, and this is so true. God has blessed us, hasn't he? He has blessed us so much, and we're just so excited. And you know what I'm looking forward to, like, among all the things, besides the sunshine, I'm looking forward to just, you know, reconnecting with some folk. You know, I had friends who were really close, you know, once. And, you know, distance is difficult sometimes to keep the, you know, when you don't see each other every day anymore. And, you know, I know there's technology, FaceTime, Skype, whatnot, but it's not the same. You know, when you hang out with people every day. I remember there was a time with some of my friends, some people back in Recife, we would just hang out like literally every day. Every day, this is a high school time, and then after we finished high school, we also still hang out. And there was this intimacy, and we would just knew each other like brothers. And you know, it's exciting to, I know some of these people now, that, you know, their lives look completely different. Some of them have kids. Some of these guys have got married. Some people have moved elsewhere. And it's interesting that we can only be a time and space, like in the present moment. We cannot live in the future. We can think about the future. We can dream, and we can contemplate on the past. But the present is really what we've been gifted with, isn't it? Like right now, our experience right now, and nostalgia. I love just thinking. It's a word in Portuguese called saudade, and basically it's like missing someone, a feeling of nostalgia. I was trying to translate exactly, and there wasn't like an exact. Say that again. Longing. Thank you, Viv. Longing, just feeling, you know, when you recall memories and you want to experience them again, but you know that it won't be the same, but it will be new and it will be fresh. And I'm looking forward to, well, just catch up, really. There's just so many things that, you know, the years have gone by and I've lost, you know, touch. And that's normal, but I'm looking forward to catch up. I do want to introduce Joanna to some folks she's not met before. You know, and it's like it's because God takes us from one place to another, and I've been blessed to have this life here in Dumfries, and this has been very, very different. You know, to my experience in Recife, it's like a different planet. And you guys who've kind of come from different countries, there's a lot of people who can relate. Yeah? You kind of, the culture, eventually, you know, you get used to some things. And normal is a very relative thing. Yeah? What's normal? Like, oh, this is normal. It's actually super strange in a different place. It just depends on the context. But anyway, I need to settle down. Apologies. Sorry about that. Looking forward to reconnecting. This is the thing about this blessing that God has given us with each other. You know, it's a great blessing to have one another, don't you think? We have friends, we have people around us. I think we need people, whether we admit it or not. You know, we need each other. We need community. I think it's one of the biggest blessings. In this human experience that we all are going through, yeah, our, you know, perspective, people give us perspective, people help us see, you know, people see what you can't see. You know, we're limited to what our eyeballs allow us to see in that moment where we are in that place. But, you know, there's things happening simultaneously as we hang out right now. You know, I wonder what's going on here at the train station. And you could go to anywhere in the world, really, and just think things are happening without us. Do you know what I mean? I know this sounds so super obvious, like, dude, where are you going with this? I don't know. No, but listen, listen, it's true. Things are happening without us. And that, for me, you know, Joanna reminds me that every day. Like, you know, Joanna says, look, listen, you know, the world doesn't revolve around you, Davi. You know, she reminds me of the fact it's not all about you. And you know, that's obvious. But why is it that I seem to live as though it is about me? And why is it that I can keep going back to that place where I see my needs as priority? Maybe it's just me that experiences this. And bear with me. If so, I'll keep preaching to myself. But here's the thing. Looking on the inside and just seeing the immediate and the need and the an emotion-driven creature that I am. Some of us are, some more than others. But we could be so, can't we? Is it just me? You're going to let me just stand here, just look like an idiot. It's like, yeah, but we'll go pray for you. Somebody's going to get you like some psychiatrist. Okay. Thank you, Talia. Let's go. It's Talia and I. Let's go. But here's the thing. Like, it is so easy to like get the focus in the wrong place. Do you know what I mean? It's so easy to just see, well, oh, but I can see what I know, what I feel. I woke up this way, and today, I don't know, you know, like, no, don't know how this week's gonna go, man. You know, do you also talk to yourself? Do you have like a voice when you wake up and you're just thinking, oh, what's gonna go with the week, calendar? And you see others as, like, you don't, I sometimes forget to see others as individuals even. I see them as like the character that plays in Davi's life. This sounds really selfish, but I'm just going to have a, like an open therapy if you don't mind. Like, it's all good if you don't mind. That's the guy. That's the guy who takes the money from football on Mondays. That's that guy. That guy's so much more than that, man. He's a human being, man. Oh, no, that's the guy who gets the cappuccino, and he's quite particular about how he wants it extra hot. And he's more than that, man. He's so much more than that, you know? But somehow, in some way, at some point, we've made it all about us. Here's the thing. In this passage of scripture that we read, we don't have time to dive into the whole thing. I read the chapter 4 for the sake of context because it just speaks for itself. And I encourage you to just dive into 2 Corinthians, okay? And linger there. Don't rush off. God will speak to you, yeah? And he's craving to hang out with you, yeah? We're going to zoom into this verse. He talks about, Paul says on verse 6, he says, for God, Steph, you're amazing, man. Get done. This guy's on the ball. Verse 6, he says, for God who said, let there be light in the darkness. It's a reference to Genesis, yeah, in the beginning, when there was nothing, and he created something out of nothing. When I talk about what we believe in, we believe in a God that doesn't need anything to create everything. The God who said, let there be light in the darkness. That's the God we're talking about. He has made this light shine in our hearts so we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. We now have this light shining in our hearts. But we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God and not from ourselves. Here's the first observation that I want to make from this verse this morning is that it is not about us. And as ouchy as that can feel to me and to some of us, it really isn't. We ourselves were like fragile clay jars. You know, I was like studying for this moment. I went off on a random, you know, procrastination, which I do this too much. I went on YouTube to look at clay jars, and then I started like looking. I got really into it. Like, I wasted so much time. And there was a video about like how to make clay out of dirt, and oh my goodness, this is so cool. But that's completely beside the point. But clay, man, is. Has anybody had a go like in pottery? I mean, I did it when I was part of River of Life Christian School. We had a trip. I remember I made some things. It was a ceramic. No, it was clay. It was clay for sure. I remember. I think it was both. But what happened was clay. So you touch you and this thing, man, and it, you know, like I'm not gonna. You should watch the video because I'm gonna butcher the whole thing if I attempt to try and talk this through. But the thing is that it's not like it's dirty. It's not nice, you know. And then once it's done and it's been put in under high temperature. And it's ready. It's this fragile thing. Yeah, it may look nice, but it's so fragile. A clay jar. I was wondering, why would Paul refer to us as clay jars? I thought for sure that we're more than that. Okay, maybe not gold jars, maybe not silver, but something, clay. Surely there's something in between. We are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. You know, I don't know about you, but when I read that, I realize how we're so fickle, aren't we? We could be so inconsistent. God, he loves us way beyond you know, what we could ever deserve. God, he's not waiting on our performance. I don't know about you, but I wake up many days thinking, oh, I'm going to get it right. Like, watch this. I'm trying to impress God, trying to gain his trust, trying to gain his attention, forgetting that actually he initiates the whole thing, man. That God wasn't waiting for me to get my act together. He's not waiting for us to get our lives sorted in order to love us. He's already loving up front. God's coming at you with love. We sometimes get it blurry, you know, the actual picture of what God actually looks like. We think it's a judge that's looking down on us. Is that keeping the tab? He's coming at you with a smile. Just let that sink in for 1 second. Just imagine God coming at you. Just like with love, so much love in his eyes. Wanting to hold you, you know, the fragile clay jar that we are. It's not about us. And the second observation that I'd like to make is that there's something inside of us. Paul calls it this great treasure. Now, we have this light shining in our hearts, but we ourselves are like fragile clay jars containing this great treasure. This makes it clear that our great power is from God, not from ourselves. You know, when God, and only he can do that, when he helps us shift our focus from our needs, and don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong about our needs, our careers. There is nothing wrong about our ambitions, our dreams. You know, there's nothing wrong with any of that. But when God helps us take our focus and shift it into the treasure that he's placed inside of us, something happens. Here's the thing. You guys already know this, but what happens is, in the story that we celebrate, the story of Jesus coming and redeeming us, you know, in Genesis, Adam and Eve, they had proximity, they had intimacy with God, they walked with God, and this was robbed by our selfishness. Yeah, we chose out of our own greed, and sin entered to the world, and one of the things that sin does is separate us from that original plan, the original intimacy that man and woman had with God. The intimacy got robbed. Here's the thing. Jesus Christ came to restore that intimacy. Jesus Christ came to free us from our selfishness, free us from our greed, free us into a life where we give our attention entirely back to where it belongs, to God. You know, Jesus, the gospel we do believe in is that Jesus, it says, actually in that same book, I didn't give this passage, but at the end there of chapter 5, verse 21 says, he who knew no sin, speaking about Jesus Christ, he who knew no sin became sin so that we might become right with God. It's not about us. It never was about us. You know, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that's also 2 Corinthians. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. If you are in Christ this morning, you are a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. This is the truth. This is where our focus should be, and God is inviting us today to put our focus where it belongs. Thank you, Jesus, that it's not about us, that although we are fragile, we are fickle, you have chosen to put a treasure inside of us. Would you help us shift our focus into that treasure? Do you know what happens when you decide to look? Have you looked? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What are you talking about, man? What are you talking about? Look at this guy's going nuts. Listen, have you seen this treasure? Paul describes this treasure in verse 6. If you could rewind, Steph, for 1 second. He says, for God who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts. Why? So that we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus Christ. Why has he placed this treasure inside of us? That's the treasure. You ready? So that we could know him. Knowing God. Do you know God? Have you seen him? Have you seen what he does? Have you experienced who he is? Thank you, Jesus. So that we could know the glory of God. The same God who said, let there be light in the darkness, has made this light shine in our hearts. Why? So we could know the glory of God that is seen in the face of Jesus. Here's the thing. Before Jesus came, you know, in between when Adam and Eve sinned and Jesus coming to restore us, there's something that would happen in between. There were attempts of being able to experience this and know God, you know, I'm going to say this, my version. I recommend that you speak to Pastor Mark or James afterwards if you want to know the details. but the tabernacle, okay? Here we go. There was a time where we couldn't, and I say we, but this was a long time ago, okay, so we weren't alive, where we couldn't come and access the glory of God. There was a time where only the high priest was allowed to come in to the Holy of Holies once in a long time. And he would have to be completely sinless in that moment. Otherwise, he would drop dead because he couldn't handle the presence of God. This is a reality of, you know, realizing who we're talking about here. This isn't just some meditation method. This isn't just some, this is the creator of heavens and earth. This is God himself, all-powerful, almighty God. And when we talk about knowing his glory, this is way beyond our heads, man. This is way bigger than we could imagine. This treasure that's inside of you, I could never describe it because I could never understand it. But the reality is that we choose to believe that it is inside, okay? And realizing that actually, God, would you make me aware of you and your greatness? Would you allow me to be captured by your splendor? Would you just take my attention from myself and divert it back to you? God wants to do that with us. And once we see him, we will be surprised. Do you know Psalmist David? I'm going to invite Joanna. Do you want to come and make it pretty? Psalmist David, thank you. He said in Psalm chapter 27, that this is the one thing that he desired of God. He said, one thing I have desired of the Lord, and that will I seek. Sorry, Steph. It's 27 verse 4. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. To behold, stare at. When was the last time that you just kind of met with God and you were just there and you were just looking? And you might be thinking, bro, this is so subjective. What are you talking about, man? You can't see God. It would kill us. I'm like, listen to me. God, he connects with us individually, differently. There is no set way. It's going to look different for Aiden, the way it looks for Duke. All he's asking of us is to be present, to make ourselves available. As we, you know, are drawing here towards the Christmas season, you know, this period of Advent, first Sunday of Advent, the first candle symbolizes hope, the people. God has put a treasure inside his people. And he wants us to dare to explore. Psalm chapter 27, verse 4 says, for one thing, thank you, Steph, I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek. What have you been seeking? Where have you been looking? Here's the reality, we're all searching for fulfillment. Is it just me? We're all looking for something to fill in the gap, man. We've been looking. We need it. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord. His one thing, his one priority was to be with God. My question to you this morning is, where have you been looking? Have you been looking at all? What are you talking about, David? Where have you been looking for love? In your experience in this life, where have you been looking for love? Is it in your partner? Is that The love that you're hoping that's going to fill you, do you think that's going to be enough to fill up the gap? Is it in your friends? Is it in your social networks? Where have you been looking for comfort? Where have you been searching for delight, approval? Where do you sit and look for acceptance? Where do you go for a relaxing laughter, a good time? How many people enjoy just a good laugh? I love to just laugh. I'm looking forward to meet some of the people that I know will make me laugh to the point that I will have to say, stop, I'm gonna die. Stop talking. Some of these guys I've not seen in a long time, you know, they're just so stupid. Just like me. But we're gonna have a good time. And where do you go for joy? Because here's the thing, we can have a good day, a bad day, we can have good weeks, bad weeks, we go through motions, months, years, man. But I'm telling you, there is a place where we can find true strength and fulfillment, and it is in the presence of God. This treasure that he's put inside of you is the treasure that we can know him for who he is. But it takes us to dare to explore this, to linger in his presence. Do you know what? God's not angry at us. He's not upset. He's just wondering when you're going to turn up, because there's so much catching up to do. There's a lot that God wants to show you individually, reveal to you, that he doesn't want to show anybody else, man. Woman, just you. And he's inviting us into that place, the Holy of Holies that was once completely separated just for the high priest. Because of the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ, he has opened the Holy of Holies for us. We have access to the presence of God. We can dwell. We can go there and we can break down the clay pots that we are. We don't have to have it all together. It doesn't have to be about your strength and your capacity of being Superman, Superwoman. It's about realizing that it was never about you. That Jesus came here and died for you and me because he wanted to. Because he loved us more than we'll ever understand. And our call is to look at him. Thank you, Jesus, that you're inviting us to behold your beauty. You know, in the original Hebrew, it was on Google. Google told me this. The beauty, it's not just beauty that we're thinking about. Oh, it's pretty. It's more than that. The meaning of the word for beauty, I'm not saying that right. It's not easily conveyed by an English word. It can also be translated as sweetness. To behold the sweetness of the Lord. One thing I have desired, one priority, and that will I seek, that will I look for, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the sweetness. Another word for that would be pleasantness, friendliness, graciousness, goodness, to behold the goodness of God, loveliness, splendor, delightfulness. When was the last time that you were captured by the awesomeness of our God? When was the last time you were captured by his splendor? As the worship team comes back up, we're about to continue worshiping this God, all-powerful, mighty, King of kings, Lord of all, Jesus Christ, our Savior. I want to encourage you to not just go through the motions of what we do. Our experience here in church, you know, can be, you know, we can get emotions. It's so easy. But I want to encourage you to look at these lyrics and see what we're actually talking about. Maybe you're sat here and you've never, or you're connected at home and you've never considered any of this. and this is completely foreign to you. And that's completely fine. Do you know, on the chapter 3 that I read just before there, Stefan, if you've got 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, the Apostle Paul says, he says, but whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, for the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Freedom to see. Freedom to see. So all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, you know, that's all that's required. You know, there's a lot being said about repentance, and a lot of folk misunderstand what it actually means to repent is to turn. To repent is to decide, you know what? I thought I knew better, but I'm going to change my mind. I'm going to turn to the Lord. You know, I'm going to turn, because how else would you see somebody unless you look? How else would you experience unless you turn up? All that God wants to say to us this morning is that He's got a lot of catching up to do with you. And He's excited, because He knows that we're on our way, aren't we? We're on our way. We don't have a lot to travel. We don't have far to travel. We don't need to catch a plane, man, to find God. We don't need to spend money on plane tickets. We just need to turn to Him. Contemplate in His temple. Behold the beauty of the Lord, and contemplate. Thank you, Jesus. What is it that you have to inquire? Just as we conclude in Psalm chapter 27, verse 4, Steph, one more time. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in His temple. What is it that you need? What is it that you want to inquire? What are the questions you've got? Because God's not afraid of our questions. He's inviting them in. Bring your questions to Him. Come. You don't have to be old Mr. Perfect clay pot, because it's not even about you. Just come. Just come. And this isn't just a Sunday morning idea. This is an invitation for the rest of our lives. Thank you, Jesus. If you could, out of respect, please bow your heads and close your eyes, and let's connect. Jesus, thank you for this invitation to connect with you, to keep in touch with you. You want to restore intimacy. You want to be close to us. You want to laugh with us. You want to smile at us. You want to love on us. Your loving kindness is overwhelming. Thank you, Jesus, for your forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. I pray as we declare and praise you right now, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you will change something on the inside of us. Thank you for your power. Thank you for the treasure that you've trusted inside of us. I pray that we will never lose sight of what matters, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Fantastic word there, Debbie. Thank you so much. And, you know, when you hear a word like that, then you have to do something about it, because otherwise it just drifts away and the moment's lost. So if you need to, you're going to have coffee and, you know, there'll be lots of people chatting. It'll get quite noisy in here in a couple of minutes. But if you want to just sit quietly, ignore everybody else, feel free. And, you know, if somebody taps you on the shoulder and says, oh, hello, then just say, just hang on a minute, I'm just talking to God. And they'll leave you alone, because, you know, it's so important that when God speaks to us, that we respond, that we do something back, because otherwise you might kind of lose it. And the moment is here, it's now. In fact, let's just take a moment without just rushing into coffee. And with that little, nice little ding, 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 then you can take your seats, you can stay standing, whatever, but just let's take a couple of minutes to talk to the Lord. Why don't we do that? Gaze upon His glorious face. Just, Lord, we realize we are just clay jars, but it's what You put inside that matters. Lord, we gaze upon Lord Jesus, we thank You that we can turn and gaze upon You at any time. Thank You for dying on the cross. Thank You for making the way through Your resurrection so that we have access to You and to the Father at any time. That we can go into that Holy of Holies and have intimate relationship, intimate understanding with You and commune with You. Thank You, Jesus. And for some of us, then, you know, this is a habit. For some of us, we're starting for the first time. For some of us, then, we're thinking, I've forgotten. And I'm turning back to the Lord. And the main thing is to know that the Lord Jesus sees right into your heart. He understands. It's like Davy said near the beginning, we're not just pawns, we're not just items to be used by Him. We're actually individuals that He loves, that He wants to have relationship and fellowship with. Isn't that amazing? That's our faith. That's our Savior. Wow. So we're going to draw the service to a close now. If you want to stay just quietly, then that's fine. If you want to get up and walk around and grab a coffee, talk to people, that's absolutely fine as well. But isn't our God amazing? What a hope and a light He shines into our hearts. It's amazing. Thank You. Thank You. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Father God. Thank You, Holy Spirit. We love and we worship You. We follow You and we honor You. We're Yours.